Hello and welcome to ITV News West Country with Seb and Kylie.
Thank you for joining us. The headlines this Thursday evening. A 15-year-old boy is sentenced to 14 months detention after he admitted stabbing a teacher at a school in Tewkesbury.
Prime Minister Rishi Sunak tells us asylum seekers will be back on the Bibby Stockholm barge off Portland, but refuses to say when.
We've got to find alternatives, of which the barge is one of the options. But more fundamentally, we've got to stop people coming here in the first place.
Also tonight, a new documentary hopes to help solve the murder of former Crime Watch presenter Jill Dando.
And we're in Bath for a special fashion show raising money for local cancer charities. Good evening. First tonight, a 15-year-old boy has been sentenced to 14 months detention after stabbing a teacher at a school in Tewkesbury.
The teenager, who can't be named, rang emergency services to warn them about the attack. The victim has recovered, but told a court that what happened in July still affects him today. Richard Payne was in court.
It was referred to in court as like something from an American high school tragedy seen on TV. But this was Tewkesbury, a normally quiet town in Gloucestershire where, on July the 10th, a large comprehensive school was in lockdown. The victim, math teacher Jamie Sansom. The attacker, a 15-year-old boy who, wearing a snood and a hoodie, drew a 6-inch knife in a corridor and said, "I'm sorry," before stabbing him once in the stomach. In a victim impact statement read in court in his absence, Jamie Sampson said he never expected this sort of thing to happen in a school, least of all to him. It was like being in some sort of soap opera, he said. I didn't have time to react. Of his attacker, the teacher says, "I bear him no ill will. I hope he gets the help he needs." The teacher was taken to hospital and released the same day, but it wasn't until several hours later, after pleas from his mother to hand himself in, that the boy was arrested on suspicion of attempted murder. He later admitted wounding with intent to cause serious harm and possessing a knife.
The first thing to do was to get officers on the scene to make sure that the school was locked down. So we had neighbourhood officers, response officers and firearms officers that were on the scene.
In defence, the court heard the attacker had suicidal thoughts and had been bullied. But the judge said the potential for harm was significant, and detaining him for half of a 14-month sentence was the only appropriate option. Campaigners against knife crime say this incident highlights serious problems amongst young people.
I'm aware of many, many knife incidents throughout schools within Gloucestershire and beyond. So I think I'm hoping that this kind of gets people again, as I've always said, around the table talking about actually this early intervention and getting organisations in schools to educate young people about the risk of knife crime.
Jamie Sansom has since left the school to teach elsewhere, but the memory of what happened here one summer's day remains. Richard Payne, ITV News, Bristol.
On to other news, and the boss of Bristol Airport says a major upgrade is the biggest project they've ever undertaken. £60 million will pay for a new multi-storey car park, better links between car parks and the terminal, improved waiting areas and better roads.
Well, it's going to enhance and deliver a much more seamless experience for passengers rather than people having to cross roads like they do at the moment. We're simplifying the whole of the road infrastructure, and as I say, people better drive straight onto the top of the multi-storey car park, get dropped off, get out of the public transport, bus, coach, and walk across directly to the terminal.
Next tonight, the Prime Minister is insisting asylum seekers will return to the Bibby Stockholm, but he's refused to say when or how much it's costing.
In an interview with ITV News West Country, Rishi Sunak said the barge is still viable after 39 men were taken off in August. Well, ahead of the Conservative Party conference, he spoke to our political correspondent, David Wood.
Prime Minister, how much is the Bibby Stockholm costing every day?
Well, it's take a step back. What is costing taxpayers every day is housing illegal
asylum to illegal migrants in hotels. It's costing us £5-6 million.
But they're still in those hotels, aren't they? And no one's on the barge.
Yeah, and we're making progress to find alternatives. And that's what we need to do. It's why one of my five priorities is to stop the boats, right? It's not right that taxpayers are forking out up to £5-6 million a day to house people in hotels. We've got to find alternatives, of which the barge is one of the options. But more fundamentally, we've got to stop people coming here in the first place, because my view is that it should be this government and our country who decides who comes here, not criminal gangs.
The only boat you've stopped so far, though, is the Bibby Stockholm, which is empty again today and has been for more than a month. How much is it costing?
Well, we're going through all the checks to make sure that it passes all the vetting and inspections.
Is it really viable? Will people move on board?
Yes, it is. It is viable. It is better alternative than hotels. It's right that we release hotels from local communities. I think across the country, and particularly in the southwest, there will be so many market towns where the hotel has been taken over to house illegal migrants. People don't think that that's right. I don't think that's right. So if we can find large sites like barges and others that we found, disused military bases, that will ease pressure on local communities. But look, fundamentally,
do you have a date then for the barge?
Fundamentally, we've got to stop people coming here in the first place.
I need to move on. As you appreciate, we're tight for time. More than 120,000 people across the West Country are on the social housing waiting list. That is going up. That has gone up since before the pandemic. Is this really the Conservative Britain that you want to be leading, where people are desperate for homes and more than 100,000 simply can't get one?
No, of course I want people to have a wonderful place to call home, whether they're renting, whether they're getting on the housing ladder, whether they're in social housing. Now, we've invested record amounts in developing social housing, so that's happening. But we need to also build more homes for our young people. And actually, the other week, we tried to deal with a bit of defective EU law that is currently blocking 100,000 homes from being built.
That's going to be nowhere enough just to solve the problem
across,
in the West Country, though, is it?
There is no single measure that can unlock more housing. Most of these homes already have planning permission, but they're being blocked by this legacy EU law. Now, we've tried to do that. The Labour Party blocked that. They blocked that in the House of Lords, and that means that we won't be able to get those homes built and people won't be able to fulfil that dream of owning their home. I think that's wrong.
Should you have a target then for how many houses should be built? Not just houses, but houses, social houses should be built each year, so at least people know what you're aiming for.
So if you, I'd say to people, you can go online, have a look at something called the Affordable Homes Programme. That's the government's signature, kind of the flagship programme for funding affordable housing.
Is it working? Because 120,000 people without a social house in the West Country alone.
So we're delivering record amounts of it. Now, I know everyone obviously want this to be faster. I acknowledge that.
Of course, just come from the Liberal Democrat conference where they've given us all little blue bricks in a wall to smash through. And of course, one of the bricks in the blue wall that fell very recently is Somerton and Froome. I didn't see you personally on the campaign trail. Are you running scared of the Liberal Democrats?
No. And look, midterm by-elections are always tricky for incumbent governments. But and we've got a couple more coming up. We're fighting them very hard. I will be out and about as I always am. But the best thing I can say to people is, look, we're focused on your priorities, halving inflation, growing the economy, reducing debt, cutting waiting lists and stuff.
I knew you'd get them in somehow.
Yeah, but it's important. I mean, you know, those are the country's priorities, those are my priorities, and we're making progress. But also, just the other week, you saw me do something different on net zero, charting a new course of net zero. That is going to save rural families across the southwest thousands of pounds. They were going to be forced to do things that would have cost a fortune, £5,000, £10,000, £20,000. I didn't think that was right. I took a lot of flack for it, but it's the right thing to do, and it will benefit families in the southwest.
Very briefly, because we're running out of time, it's the first time we've spoken to you on this. In terms of major policies, are you committed, like your predecessors, to the full dualling of the A303 and a dual carriageway by Stonehenge?
Yeah, I think I announced it when I was Chancellor. It was my first budget. I'd been in the job for about 3 weeks.
David Cameron announced it, Nick Clegg announced it, Theresa May announced it, Boris Johnson announced it.
From memory, I think it's going through the planning process, and there have been some legal things that it's working through. But I said, I think you can go back and look at my first budget speech as Chancellor in 2020. I talked about the A303 in that speech. I know how important it is for local connectivity, and of course we're committed to it.
We're out of time. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
David talking to Rishi Sunak there. Now you're watching ITV News here in the West Country with Seb and Kylie. Thanks very much for your company this Thursday evening. There is, of course, still plenty more to come, including Charlie's here and we'll have your forecast. So, any more stormy weather coming, Charlie?
Not to the same degree as the last 24 hours or so, but we are in a very kind of topsy-turvy autumnal weather pattern, and I'll explain a bit about what's causing that in just a few minutes' time.
Topsy-turvy weather, right? We'll find out. But before that, the murder of Jill Dando is one of the most high-profile crimes in living memory, and one which remains unsolved.
Her brother Nigel is hoping a new documentary will help uncover new information. We'll hear from him in a moment, but first let's look back at a murder which shocked a nation.
She was the West Country's golden girl, who became one of the most famous faces on television.
Call me old-fashioned, but there's something rather special about a family day out on the British coast.
Born in Weston-super-Mare, Jill Dando worked as a newsreader for BBC Spotlight in Plymouth before launching her national career. But in April 1999, at the peak of her fame, she was shot dead on the doorstep of her London home in broad daylight.
The news came in that a woman had been killed. And these rumours started going around the newsroom that it was Jill. And it went terribly quiet.
Now a Netflix documentary is revisiting her unsolved murder.
This was one of the largest murder investigations the Metropolitan Police ever had to face.
It was the biggest reward in criminal history in this country.
Today, a man was arrested on suspicion of murder.
Barry George was jailed for the crime, but 8 years later released as an innocent man. Now it's being asked once more, who killed Jill Dando?
Why would they kill her? What benefit would anybody accrue from killing Jill Dando?
The files should still be open on this case. They should be looking.
To be sitting here 24 years on and saying that we still do not know who killed Jill Dando is mind-boggling.
Really has remained a mystery. And earlier we spoke to Nigel Dando, Jill's brother, who appears in the new documentary. And I started by asking him what it was like watching it.
Well, it's a powerful piece of work, that's for sure. Netflix came to me with the idea that they wanted to do perhaps a fuller piece about Jill, her life, what happened on the day she died, and the police investigation to try to catch her killer. It is a thorough piece of work, and it really highlights not only Jill's qualities, what led her to becoming probably the TV star of her day, but also the efforts that the police put in trying to catch whoever murdered her.
I can't imagine what it must be like losing a sibling, but to have nobody in prison for her murder, what does that feel like?
Well, you live in hope that somebody is going to be arrested for the crime and convicted of it and serve their due time in prison. But the police have worked exhaustively on this case, and we just await the day, unlikely to happen, I think probably in my lifetime, but you just don't know. But there's always the chance that somebody may come forward and confess, or somebody who knows something about who did it, they may come forward and give police that vital piece of evidence that is still missing.
Mm. What was that moment like when you heard the news?
Well, I was working in the newsroom of the Bristol Evening Post at the time, and I'd taken a call from a friend of mine who worked on the Daily Mail, who said that Jill had been involved in some sort of accident, didn't know exactly what it was, and he rang back later to say that he thought it was a bit more serious, that Jill had actually been stabbed outside her home and was in hospital. So the alarm bell started ringing, and I eventually got hold of her fiance Alan, who told me that he was speaking to me from the back of a police car where he'd been picked up from the hospital where he was working. And they were on their way to Charing Cross where Jill had been taken. And then the call was taken over by a police officer who was with him, who told me that Jill had been pronounced dead at the hospital. So that's how I found out.
Gosh, it must have been the most awful thing that could happen. So many of us, of course, maybe felt like we knew Jill because we saw her on our screens, and personally for me, I grew up watching her. It was very inspirational to me. But what was she like personally to you as a sister, as a family member?
Well, what you saw on TV was what you got in private. Jill was very bubbly, she was very warm, she was very friendly, very outgoing, very caring. And she carried that over from the screen into her private life. But she never lost the common touch. She was just always Jill. And I think it was the natural qualities that she brought to the TV screen that really made her such a beloved figure. I mean, she was known in virtually every household in the country when all this happened.
It's a real testament that she's so fondly loved still as well.
Yes, that's right. Yeah.
Nigel, thank you so much for speaking to us
about
this.
Thank you.
Thank you. Nigel, who came in a little earlier to speak to us, you know, she is, like you said, just one of those people who still remembered.
Still remembered. And, yeah. And Nigel, who I've known for a while, and he still speaks so powerfully about that moment. It must have been so difficult for the whole family.
OK, next, the results of a first-of-its-kind survey exploring the lives of black people in Britain have been published today.
The Black British Voices Project says their findings show there's still work to be done when it comes to making black people feel like they belong in Britain. Amrit Birdie reports.
The Black Lives Matter movement inspired millions across the globe to protest against racism and inequality. It also inspired the launch of the Black British Voices Project, a survey of 10,000 black people in Britain, aiming to uncover their real lived experiences.
Black voices matter. You know, we've had, we know some of the disparities, the racial disparities that exist, but we wanted to find out in detail how the black community felt about those disparities. And some of the findings that we found was that just 1 in 10 of those black Brits we surveyed feel definitely proud to be British. And so we have to ask questions about why people are, you know, are as British as anybody else, actually feel that Britain is not their home.
Participants were asked questions on a range of subjects, from how they identify to opinions on the national curriculum and the media. The study found that 98% feel they have to compromise who they are in the workplace. 95% feel not enough is being done to combat racism in sport. And 1 in 6 black Britons do not consider themselves to be British. And when it came to young people, some of the figures were even more striking, with 90% of young black people expecting to experience racial prejudice as adults. These figures came as no surprise to equality campaigner Mariama Adan from Bristol.
As a black person in the UK, it just kind of mirrors my lived experience of being black. The biggest reason as to why I think this research will positively affect society is because it's made by black people, and it's been the narrative within that survey is like black narrative, it's black people's narrative.
Leah Mahon has worked with some of the young people that took part in the survey, and she believes the key to change could lie with them.
I think young people should feel inspired that this is the first step out of many reports and surveys and research of what we can do to see how we can move forward as a community. And I hope that this inspires them to speak up.
The government told ITV News that Britain is a more equal place for black people than ever before. But those behind the Black British Voices project say the survey proves that there is still a long way to go.
Amrit Birdie reporting there. Now, the family and friends of a Bristol rugby player who died after a cardiac arrest have raised more than £66,000 to fund more defibrillators.
Sam Paledry collapsed in Millennium Square in 2022, where there was no access to a defibrillator. The foundation set up in his name is now installing life-saving equipment across the city and teaching people how to use it.
I heard them say this morning that Sam would be so proud, and especially when the defibrillators that they've cited have been used. They say this is exactly what Sam would be wanting us to do. He'd be so incredibly proud.
Now, a special group of people are in Bath getting ready to hit the catwalk for an important cause.
All the models at Strength in Style fashion show are cancer patients or nurses and doctors. It's to raise money for three charities, and Verity Wishart sent this a little earlier.
Well, I'm here at the Assembly Rooms in Bath, where this evening some very brave individuals are strutting their stuff, taking to the catwalk, all in aid of local cancer charities. Now, the twist here is the models themselves are cancer patients, nurses and doctors. Now, let's talk to one of the representatives from one of the charities. This is Laura. Laura, why is it so important that this event this evening is going ahead?
Well, this event is very unique because you've got three charities coming together, collaborating, putting on a unique event to help people affected by cancer or life-limited illnesses.
Absolutely. And what sort of things can we expect tonight? What's involved in the fashion show?
Well, just a big thank you, really, to the Bath boutiques that have just supported us and provided us with some amazing outfits for the evening. But like you said, the reason why it's so different is because everyone here has either been affected by cancer or life-limited illnesses that are modelling themselves.
Absolutely. And is the aim to sort of fundraise and raise awareness?
So we hope to raise awareness of each charity and obviously show people that you can live with an illness. And you will see this tonight, actually, when people showcase themselves.
Lovely. Thank you so much, Laura. Now let's meet one of those very special models that's going to be strutting their stuff tonight. Lee, thanks so much for joining us.
You're welcome.
How are you feeling ahead of this evening?
Very excited, thank you. Yeah, it's good. It's sort of taking me out of my comfort zone, but I'm ready for it.
Absolutely. You'll do a cracking job, I'm sure. And why is it so important for you that you got involved in tonight's event?
Well, We Get It means so much to me. When I was looking for help when I was going through different stages of cancer, they were there for me. They've made me do things I wouldn't normally do, and it's a great sense of community that the group provides, and so yeah, it's really, really helpful for me.
Absolutely. Any pre-show nerves?
Not really. You can see from what I'm wearing that's gone now. That's gone.
Just a professional. You're ready to go.
Yeah.
Amazing. Well, the models are ready, the stage is set, and all for a fantastic cause. It's a sold out audience here tonight, so all that's left for us to say is best of luck.
Verity there. Yeah, I'm sure it's going to be great.
It's going to be great, yeah.
It's weather forecast time now, and Charlie is here, so that doesn't look too good.
No, I just want to give you a very brief kind of 101 lesson on the jet stream, effectively. At the moment, it's been very stormy, and as we head through the course of tonight, we're going to see a little bit of rain. That's because as long as the UK sort of sits in this kind of area with the jet stream to the south, then we are on a cold or stormy side. But as you can see into the weekend, the UK sits to the south of the jet stream. That's going to allow higher pressure building, which loosely means we're going to see some settled weather. But then, of course, it all changes again. This is often the case as we head through the course of autumn. But don't worry, because as we head through towards Tuesday, a bit more high pressure close by.
Whatever the weather, it always feels like home. Valent Heat Pumps and Boilers sponsor ITV West Country Weather.
Well then, some pretty wet weather to come as we head through the rest of this evening, but it will clear through, leaving us with a fine day on Friday and much lighter winds than we saw 24 hours ago or so. But that's still with low pressure in charge. That's the one that's going to give us a bit of rain through the next few hours. Then high pressure builds in through Friday and at least into the first half of the weekend. You can see that it wants to kind of get eroded by this next weather system here as we work our way through Sunday and into next week. Very typical kind of changeable autumnal setup in the big picture. Oh yes, some persistent rain for the next few hours. Turns a bit more showery as we work our way towards midnight. There's a couple of gusty winds mixed in with there, but into the early hours it clears through, the winds change direction, and they kind of clean the air, if you like, leaving us with some pretty cloudless skies and a relatively mild night still, lows of 12 or 13 degrees by tomorrow morning. And therefore that translates to a lot of sunshine as we work our way through the course of Friday. One or two very isolated light showers might just work their way in on those westerly winds, but for most, a fine day, and again, those temperatures up to about 18 or 19 degrees at a push, but in the sunshine and light winds, it'll feel really quite fine and warm. And it stays that way through Saturday. High pressure stays with us, weather stays the same, but as we head into Sunday and that low pressure starts to work its way through, the skies will be that little bit cloudier. We'll see just an increased chance of seeing a few outbreaks of rain. It'll probably last into next week as well. But you can see temperatures by day still stay on the warm side. The nights, though, might just be a little bit chillier. But while we have some sunshine, as Kim saw a couple of days ago, little trip out to Lady Bay at Clevedon, the opposite end to the Marine Lake, but some gorgeous views, some lovely skies, a very calm scene.
Valent Heat Pumps and Boilers sponsor ITV West Country Weather.
That's it, isn't it?
Almost it, Kylie. This is normally about the time I would say goodbye to everyone, but I'm actually rather sadly going to say goodbye to you.
Yeah. This is my last show.
I can't believe I'm actually doing this. This is your last show.
I'm not going to cry.
I am.
Don't cry, it's not me.
It's not going to be great, is it? It's been a short time working with you, but it's been the most wonderful experience.
Thank you
so much for that. I am going to let you say something in a minute. But, but first, let's show you some of the amazing memories you've left us with over the last few years.
Okay. Tonight, I'm going to have it's actually really hard. A real good time. I'm not helping, to be honest, am I? You're doing all the work, aren't you? And the world, I'm turning inside.
This is the most visited spot in Antarctica.
Well, a great story there of
the nasty party.
To party in large groups this weekend. Glastonbury Festival coming up tonight.
This is what beautiful.
Oh, it's me. This honestly. You know what? I think this is the best lineup yet.
Also, you agree with me at long last.
This year.
Fantastic. Weather.
Are you pleased with the lineup?
Oh, I'm a big Ed Sheeran fan, I have to confess.
My favourite one was where you kind of, right, I'll do my best demo. You like got your hands on your handlebars and then flipped your legs in the air and you were like standing up.
Like a handstand.
That's it.
Yeah, yeah.
Is that a hard one?
Is this your first festival, and if it is, how are you feeling about it?
Believe it or not, yeah, 42 years old and it's my first festival, so, and obviously the first time here, so I'm excited.
It's starting to look like a balloon now.
I've actually lost you at the moment.
You've lost us at the moment.
There we go. I'm finished.
And then you should reapply in a couple of hours.
Perfect. I look great, don't I?
Well, I'm here with Pia now and little Louis, who's been jumping around entertaining us all.
Now, what better place to go when it's cold and we're outside but to the local pub, and here we are. We've actually come outside because we can't get a signal inside, probably because of the weather.
As you can see, and Barry's over there in the corner. He's operating Versius. Speaking quite quietly because they're obviously all concentrating on what's going on here.
Now, the whole programme was being anchored from location. Can I start again? I said rather than whole.
Wow, I bet you all can't wait to see these vegetables, can you?
Yeah.
Now, it's taken months of rehabilitation, but finally they're going back into the ocean. Right, I'm going to say goodbye to you. Good luck.
Yeah, thanks.
I'm proud of you. You'll be fine. Not gonna cry.
Oh, bravo. That is so lovely.
Oh, it's so nice to see all that amazing stuff. I've had such fun. I mean, you can see, can't you?
Yeah.
How much fun I've had here. I'm not gonna cry.
You are gonna cry. I'm gonna cry. I just can't believe you're going.
I know.
I'm really sad.
And I should say thank you to everyone who's watched over the years, because of you, we have our jobs. So thank you for watching. And thank you for the brilliant team that I work with every single day, because you don't see them, but without them, you wouldn't see any of this. So yeah, thank you to you all. You're amazing. Not gonna cry. And now Charlie's got some lovely flowers for Seb.
Yes, thank you very much.
It's been wonderful working with you, Seb, for the last, no, funny you should say, actually, these are for you.
Oh,
thank you for the last 5 years
so
of my
gorgeous.
Career. You've been absolutely brilliant.
Oh.
But as you just said, it isn't just us saying goodbye, because there are lots of people behind the scenes that would like to say goodbye to you as well, right now.
Oh, look! Oh, bless you. Oh, look. So, yeah, look. Oh! Where are you all? There's normally people sitting there. Look. Oh, there they are. There's Downsy on sound. Hello. Kissy, kissy. Oh, Freddie. Oh, Lorraine. That's Tim, our brilliant director. Lucy, Ben in the corner. There's me. Yay. Oh, thank you so much.
We really are going to miss you. We really are going to. Leave me with one eye at least. Thank you so much for all these lovely memories.
Yeah,
we're going to miss
been,
you.
It's been amazing. Thank you so much, everyone who's watched. Yeah, I've loved every minute. Thank you.
One last time. Goodbye from
bye-bye.
The two of us.
Bye-bye.
Bye.